I run a company called Fusion Charts, which builds data visualization components. I did not start out to build a company. It was a way for me to make pocket money. For the last 10 years, it has helped me make a little bit of pocket money. We are now 60 people across Bangalore and Calcutta. Frankly, what we do is build JavaScript components, which other companies, anybody who wants to build a dashboard or a report, they use us. So I've got 21,000 clients. My focus area is building such visualizations and setting it as a framework or a library to other businesses. So I used to be a tech guy. Like till 2010, most of the code shipped by the company was hand coded by me, but 2010 things started growing, and since then I've not had a look at the code. So for the last 3 years, I've kind of been at zero technical knowledge. So if you're going to throw some tech questions at me, I'll probably just be using my old experience. Might not be as updated. But my focus is how do you use visualization in business, and how do businesses perceive visualization? So there's this whole, data visualization in the last couple of years has gotten a whole lot of traction. And you've seen different kinds of visualization. There's the old typical BI and business visualization. You're seeing the new form as infographics and data journalism. And you're seeing some really cool data visualization, which it takes hours to just understand what the guy was even trying to visualize. And all of these together are forming a very interesting, they are converging at a very interesting point where there's so much more data available today, and all of we are working on that. But what I'm going to be specifically focusing on is the business data visualization part. The good part is most of the learnings from here can be extrapolated to any visualization that you're doing. So I'm going to be talking very specifically about charts and charts and charts and how business use charts. But anything which is implied here can be abstracted, extrapolated, and be put into your data visualization wherever you're doing. So the way I've structured my talk is there are two parts to it. First is the Gyan part. And the Gyan part, I thought, so based on my interaction with clients, a lot of clients tell me, this is the data, now visualize it. The problem is, you don't just start with data and start with the visualization saying that, you know what, I'm going to just convert this into visualization. It is more like the typical hacking process where you say that, you know what, I can code, let's go build a code without knowing what am I going to build, how my environment would look like, what would my ALM be like, and you backtrack it. Data visualization is also a process. It's not like, throw me some data and I'm going to convert it into visualization. So the first part talks a little bit about the process, how to structure that process, because this is still, this is not still something set in stone. So this is something which is my opinion, some parts borrowed from a few other industry people and which I've put in. And the second part is more about the visual part, where I'm going to show that this is what we think is right and this is what is wrong, and this is how does it relate to the human brain, the cognitive thinking and the visual function of the brain. So quickly, we are generating around 2.5 quintillion bytes of data. That's 10 to the power 18 every single day. And right now, this is from Jess3. So right now we're at the data capture and organizing stage, which is where the big data comes into play. Small efforts are going under in the understanding part, but optimization and leveraging is still not happening, and this is what will happen over the next few years, because this part is already there, and this is increasing with the Internet of Things, with all the sensors capturing more data. Organizing is still happening at very thin level. More and more people are now getting becoming data scientists, and they're recognizing that data is now something like an item on your corporate balance sheet. Till today, data is something which is not being valued, but if you look at some of the biggest companies, like Google's and the Facebook's, they're valued for the data, and it will eventually be a part of your corporate balance sheet. Understanding of data, right now, to understand what is to be understood is also very early. Like, you have this past set of data, what can you make out of that? That understanding is still not there, and people are trying to figure it out. There's a very beautiful book on this one called Big Data by Victor Mayers, if you guys want to pick it up. Al Bielian, who's Google's chief economist, he said that the ability to take data, to be able to understand it, to process it, to extract value from it, to visualize it, to communicate it, that's going to be a hugely important skill over the next few years. So, the way I look at it is, data visualization is not just technology. It's technology mixed with art, mixed with science, and there's obviously a whole lot of maths behind it. So it's a multidisciplinary stream where a lot of them can be learned vocationally. You don't have to necessarily be an academician to be able to learn that. And the way I define it is, it's a visual display of measurable quantity, which means anything which you can measure, using these six things: points, lines, and curves. You have a coordinate system, whether in 2D or 3D. You have numbers, you have shading, you have color, and you have symbols. There's one more thing on top of it, which is in alphabets, which you can put on the data visualization. That is the core. Those are the four constituents of data visualization, and it has a clear purpose: either to understand data, to substantiate an already known or something which a hypothesis which you are forming or to discover from data. So based on this, there are three kinds of data visualization. Typically people say two, but there's a third one which is up and coming, artists using data for self-expression. So the first one is explanatory, which is built around a specific thing. So anything which you see in the papers is explanatory because the guy has already figured out what he wants to show. He's pointing it as a story to you and you're just absorbing that story through the data visualization. The second one is exploratory, which some of you guys are doing here today, where you have the data and you're trying to figure out if there's a pattern in the data. And then the final one is the exhibition of the data, which is the data as an art. And now we're changing gears. So in terms of business data visualization, so most of the business data visualization today that is there is explanatory. Today, there's right now there's a new breed of tools coming up which is called visual analytics or visual exploration, which are exploratory tools. So you must have heard of Tableau software of sorts, ClickView also. These form into the go into the exploratory. But irrespective of what you do, there are three basic steps which we think are essential for a business data visualization. Know your audience and need for data visualization, and this is a framework. Choose the right visualization, and once you have done both of those, which are functional things, then go ahead and enhance the visualization, which means you add insights to it and where you make it more stylish or whatever you want to do with it. Now, knowing your audience constitutes of three parts. What role is this information for? Is it a C-level guy who's going to look at it? Is it analyst? Is it operational guy or somebody else? What department does he belong to? Sales, management, marketing? And third, what is the metric that will interest him achieve and help him achieve his goals? So going back, the first step is knowing your audience. There are three steps in knowing your audience. Now, this is abstraction of data by role. So if it's a C-level guy, he's looking at very strategic level data. He's looking at very top level data to look at the health of his business. He's not interested in your very minute data. He's not interested in real-time data. He needs to know things like simple summaries and indicators. Then you have the analyst whose job is to figure out value from data, and he might need real-time data. So for him, the data, he would need detailed query analysis, he would need detailed data with precision. And then you have the operational guy who needs the data as is right now to complete the task in hand, which means events, alerts, and all of those kind of data. So this is data required by department. The sales would need leads, conversions, average sale value, closure time, marketing visits, acquisitions, whole lot of independent department-based data. Now what is interesting is, when you match role and department, and then the goal of that guy who's looking at it, that constitutes a metric. So for example, in customer support itself, there are three different roles. You have the support executive, you have the head of customer support, and then you have the CEO. Within customer support, they need to look at different metrics. So the support executive sees the number of tickets assigned to him, his personal turnaround time. The head of customer support sees total number of tickets by department, and issue type and the turnaround of the team and efficiency as well. And the CEO is only interested about one thing: what is the customer satisfaction index? So even when you're looking at support data, segmented by role, so support is a department, segmented by role, then match that role and department and then figure out what is that metric. Similarly in sales, the sales associates see the number of leads target allocated, sales team heads see the number of leads for each team, conversion rates, closure, VP sales sees pipeline for all the team members, and CEO sees projected revenue versus actual. All of this is derived from the same flat data, but how they're sliced and diced for each role is very important, because if you give the number of leads to the CEO, he might not be that interested. So when you're building a visualization, even though you have the data, first you have to understand your audience, that role, that department, marry the role and department, which forms the goal, and that goal is equal to the metric. So there's a 7-step process. Okay, just before that. So any metric which you're visualizing, ensure that it drives a business goal in a dashboard or whatever you're doing, which means it should be linked to a business outcome. If it's not linked to a business outcome, nobody really cares to see that data point because it's not helping him do his work better. B should not be a vanity metric. And we all know what vanity metrics are. And C, just because you have some data does not mean you have to show it. Personally, I think the best visualization of planet Earth would be one day when I wake up and see my mobile, it shows me a red or green. Green means everything in life is good, red means something is wrong. And only when it's red, I tap on it to see what goes wrong. Think about it. You don't have to worry about any visualization. You don't have to worry about any data. Data is a means, or data and data visualization is a means for you to get control over something. If the control is so simple, a red and a green, and when it's green, you don't worry about anything else, and red is something when you click on it. Can it get simpler than that? But to get to that simplicity, it's a lot of work, because then you have to figure out each and every metric and how they tie it up into that single big metric to be able to give you red and green. So just because you have some data doesn't mean you have to show it. It's best to show least amount of data which is linked to a business outcome. And this is more a seven-step framework. This is actually borrowed, not mine. So typically when you go into organization, an organization says, hey, you know what, we need to be data driven, or we need to have a dashboard, or we need to be driven by visualizations. What happens is you just go and look at the data and you start churning out some dashboards, and in the end you will have 10 different dashboards, 3 for marketing, 3 for sales, 3 for the CEO, and none of them converge to a point. What is important is all of those data visualizations converge to a point by role and by department. And to know how to make them converge, there are 7 steps to it, and these are the steps. So first you define the company goal, both short term and long run. What is the company trying to do? Second, what would it take to reach those goals, which are your key performance indicators, or key result indicators? Then what activity would you need to do to be able to reach those goals? List all such activities. Then take up the top 20%, because there's an 80-20 rule. 20% of your activities will contribute to 80% of reaching that. Take up those 20%. Find a responsible owner for each of those activities, because he's the guy who's doing the activity, monitoring it and tracking it. He's solely responsible for that. Then you have to figure out, how do you measure progress that it is going on? So let's say when you're doing a project, how do you measure how close are you to completion? Is it based on number of lines of code, number of function points, number of stories completed, or whatever your metric is? And out of those indicators, you're going to divide it into 3 buckets, which are already being measured and reported, which can be measured, and which cannot yet be measured because of data not being available, or because you haven't figured out a way to quantitatively put it. After this, you will have a set of 3 or 4 metrics per role. If you have more than 4 metrics, it means we need to redo this process, because at any point in time, you cannot control more than 4 metrics. 4 metrics means 4 different stream of activities, which means you have to monitor those 4 things. Anything which goes wrong with that, you have to go and fix it and get that metric back again. So if you see a dashboard with 50 different charts and metrics, yes, it may look cool, it might look like a lot of work, it's not. The best dashboard is which can fit on your iPhone screen. 4 very simple metrics, tops, not more than that. So now that the Gantt part is over, so let's move to some part of visualization. So, okay, I'll quickly recap the thing. We did 3 things here. We knew, we had to know our audience, which is what we just covered. The second is, how do we choose the right visualization, which is what we'll cover now. So there's a whole lot of theory behind how human brain works, and the human brain has much more power in terms of pattern recognition than your computer today. Think of it. If you're in a room with 50 people, the moment you enter, you can recognize each of those 50 people. Today, computer cannot do that. So 80% of our brain is visual function. The rest is cognitive function. The cognitive function gets kicked only when you force it to be active. The visual function is always active. You always are looking out and you're recognizing patterns. Something happens, it triggers alert in your brain that something has happened around you. So when you're building data visualization, it's very important to capture or leverage that 80% of the brain, where we intend to maximize the pre-attentive processing. Pre-attentive processing is where you're not. So think of it this way: when you're going out and having a cup of coffee, suddenly a car comes towards you while you're still focused on your coffee, but something happened there because of which an event or a trigger was raised in your mind. That is pre-attentive processing. You're not focused on that car, you're not looking at that car, but it triggered something. When you're delivering a visualization, part of know your audience is, what is the medium of delivery? Is it the web? Is it a PowerPoint presentation? Is he using it on his tablet? And what is the skill set of the user? Is he an analyst, a C-level, your mom and dad, or the mechanic? And the design choice should support the comprehension of data. So this is what I'm covering. And Edward Tufte, how many of you know about or have read Edward Tufte? Stephen Few? Okay. So Edward Tufte is one of the, I mean, he has some seminal books on this. He has a concept called data ink ratio, which means what is the percentage of data versus ink on your paper. And you have to increase that, which means less of chart chunk or less of distractions and more value, so that every pixel that you're using has deliberate meaning to it, and you're not just using it for fancy stuff or some useless stuff. So I just talked about this. A visual function is extremely fast compared to the cognitive function. 80% is visual function. Yeah, so this is what I mean by pre-attentive processing. when you're rendering a visualization, it's always on two axes. The third perceived axis, Z axis, can be used for 3D, but still it's a 3D on a 2D because computer screens are flat. So we have another axis which we can use to showcase things which human brain can easily process. Let me give you an example. The moment you look at this set of square, what is the first thing that you look at? The aberration here. And you're not even thinking about it. Now if you look at it in sequence, everywhere where you're looking, you're just looking at the aberration without even thinking about the aberration. And this is because your brain is doing pre-attentive processing, where it's not forcing itself to think on it, but because there's something different, it just catches your eye and goes into the visual function, and then it processes it differently. And these are things, something which we will use in data, which we use in data visualization to highlight or to point out a certain thing. So the Z axis, like in this, the Z axis is change of color. In this, the Z axis is change of shape. In this, the Z axis is change of size. We can use change of texture. We can use a change of orientation where the square could be tilted by, let's say, 45 degrees. And these things catch eye when you're building a data visualization. So when you want to get the user to focus on something, we use these tricks. So one thing which at least we, based on our customer inputs, we have figured out that we have 90 charts in our suite. Over 90% of our users use just 10 charts. The rest of the 80 charts do not get used. It's a very rare case that they get used, and therefore very specific purposes, because the world does not understand those charts. If somebody has to put effort to understand the chart, to be able to understand the data, he might as well look at the data itself and not look at the chart. The world is not full of statisticians. So when you're making a, and which goes back to know your delivery medium. If it's a one-on-one and you're talking to your stock broker, yes, he will understand a candlestick chart. But if you're showing the price of Apple for an average guy to understand why his stock prices have gone up with Apple or whatever it is, he needs a line chart. So here are your data visualization experts or your analysts or your domain experts who will understand many of the visualizations. So if you're doing a one-on-one, if you're doing a PowerPoint for these guys, it's okay. But if you're doing a mass story, if you're doing it on the web for your consumer website, or let's say even for a business where you know that different roles will be involved, you can't use any of the fancy charts. You have to stick to the basics, something which people understand. People adapt fast, they learn fast, but then they need to be guided. So every new user who comes into your system to look at that visualization will need to be guided before you can actually build a visualization for that guy. So fundamentally in business, there are five types of basic representation. Either you have a single figure, which is a KPI as we call it. This can be represented as a gauge or speedometer or whatever you wanted, but this is the fundamental concept. This is a single figure with historical context. So you have a spark line, which can also be a spark column. And then you have an indicator of how it's going up or down. Then you have a comparison of data. That's always a column or a bar chart. So comparison is where you're not trying to find the trend. You're seeing who's the highest and who's the lowest. So never use a line chart for that. It's always a column chart. The reason being, as humans, we have a tendency to go left to right. That is how we've been trained, and we can track our line very well. So if you give somebody a straight line, he can tell you pretty much if it's a straight line or not, if the painting is hung straight or not, and most people are very good at it. So when you go left to right, your visual function automatically picks it up and says that this guy is the most. When you have to see how a trend is changing, a pattern is changing over time, which is linear or sequential, but connected as a set of events, this chart is not good, because then you have to first think how the patterns are going. Here the pattern is already established for you. So you can clearly say that it's a bottommost here, it's a topmost here, or relatively flat here. And the third is composition. So there are enough, composition is when five items make a combined entry. So let's say here number of employees across four cities. That makes your total number of employees in a company. So pie chart is one of the most used and abused chart in data visualization. It is practically the worst chart to use, because if I ask you, is this pie bigger, is this pie bigger? There's no guarantee that you can tell me comparing both of them, because our brain is not prepared to comprehend angles and then compare angles. We are not so good at comparing angles, right, in a pie chart. Alternate for a pie chart is actually a sorted column chart, but still, there are people who prefer a pie chart and they want a pie chart, so especially when you're selling to clients, you can't say no to a pie chart.
Say, one quick question on the bar chart, I mean, your sense of vertical versus horizontal.
So vertical versus horizontal is actually not a question of sense. It's about how big your data tables are. If you look here, here all the data labels actually have to come in a straight line.
Yeah.
But there, each of your data labels come one data label per line. So if you have longer labels, you use a bar chart. If you have shorter labels, you use a column chart.
Yeah.
So that's a function of space.
Asking about so human comparison,
So there also you go in a straight line. So when you're looking at a painting, right, think of it. On a wall, you're looking at a painting. If somebody tells you, is this painting straight or not? Some people look at the top part of the painting, some people look at the side part. But both of those are straight lines, and we can comprehend that pretty well.
So they are as good, I mean, horizontal or vertical?
Horizontal and vertical is as good, right. But people prefer this because it takes some more horizontal space. So if you look at any of the device apart from an iPhone, we have more horizontal space on our screen as opposed to vertical space. So, and that's an interesting discussion altogether. On a smartphone, a whole lot of the theories of data visualization, which is applicable to PC and Mac, does not apply. That's a completely different paradigm. Today, what we are seeing is most of those paradigms being transferred over to an iPhone. And which is where there's a huge opportunity if any one of you are planning to build. So we are already doing something in that space, and we are kind of realizing the challenges, but it's a completely different and so much fun subject. So, as I mentioned, there could be innumerable types of data visualization. I mean, last count I had, there are known 250 plus chart types. And then if you go to, let's say, flowing data or infostatics.com or let's say one of these data visualization.ch, every new set of data has a different kind of visualization. So there's no limit to what you can visualize, how you can visualize. But again, remember that any complex visualization will need domain knowledge and ability to understand that visualization to understand the data. So that's two steps away from your data, not one step away. So do not build very complex complex visualizations unless you are absolutely sure about your audience. So now what I'm going to do is show you some good and some bad visualizations, some fallacies, some mostly visuals. Again, this is on very simple business charts, but the topics or the points which I'm trying to make can be extrapolated. So if you want stop me or just want me to skip fast, just let me know. So again, communicate more than data to the user. Do not leave the processing to the user. If the user has to process the visualization, he might as well look at the raw data. This is an example, So here, this is the sales target and the sales achieved for a sales guy. Look at this and say, tell me if this guy is going to get a bonus or is he going to get fired? Oh.
And the last one is December.
No, I don't think he'll get a bonus. Neither will you get
So
here what we're trying to do is we're comparing his actual numbers in a line chart with a zero axis, which is the worst thing to do. The first thing to improve this chart is not to have 0 to 50,000. You have it from here to somewhere here, which gives a wider scope of comparison. This is white space here, this is white space. Second is, this chart is actually not the right thing. We're trying to see did it perform on every single month, which means we need a clear indicator. January, did it perform? Which means, what is the difference between this and this? What is the difference between this and this? If you perform, it's a green. If it does not perform, it's a red. This is the right representation for that. Surely you want to get fired. 8 out of 12 months, he did not come up to his mark. So, same data, different chart. And the thing is, the way we have also plotted the data. Here we are plotting the actual revenue achieved by him and the target. Here we are plotting the difference of that data. Stark difference and how you plot it. So, if I'm the sales guy, I'm going to use this chart. But if I'm the manager, I'm going to use this chart. So, back to the pie chart. If your manager or your client says, I have to use a pie chart, and he has to use a pie chart for legit reasons and not to hide his data, always use labels and give a legend to it. Now you can see this 23 and this 23 are same. But if you look here, this will look much bigger than this because of the way we comprehend angles at the front, the visual function of it. Does this look bigger to you than this?
Yeah.
It's not. Both of them are 23.
Okay, so you
should
call
it. Correct.
But
so
why is that?
So, the visual function. So, in a pie chart, anything which is nearer to us in terms of angle, perceived looks bigger to us because of the way our visual function works, as opposed to something at the back. If you look at the perception of light poles, the one in the front is the biggest because it's the closest to us. The one in the back is smallest. So that's the basic theory is this. This is obviously going to be slightly more different. But if you have to actually hide something, pie chart is very good.
But
trying to hide it even more, make it a 3D pie chart.
Yeah, like isn't this a 2D one? So how does the front back thing happen? I thought it'll happen for a 3D pie chart beautifully.
So the point is, in a 3D pie chart, it's actually bigger.
3D is obviously bigger. Yeah.
But
in a 2D, I was wondering how it's closer to me and that. So the bottom one is, you're assuming it to be like how we perceive it is more on a tilted axis. So if I flip the chart,
correct.
The black will seem less and the blue will seem more.
No, so if you flip the chart, that's correct.
Yeah.
Correct. So that's the way it, our brains perceive. So I'll have to get more into research to know why that happens. But I know basically that fundamentally when you look at angles, we can't comprehend.
I believe from where you are viewing it, the top one must be looking larger. Because
it also depends on the colors used.
So this is a very interesting, most of you might have seen it. Take a grey circle, same color, right? Put behind that grey circle a rectangle of lighter grey, and put behind that grey circle a rectangle of darker grey. Suddenly the same circle will look in different size because of the contrast around in the colors around. And those are tricks which are used a lot in gaming and animation industry as well. This is pie chart. This is a simple trick, business trick. If you want to actually, so this is actually a good replacement for a pie chart. You do a sorted bar chart instead of a pie chart, because then I can clearly see what is happening. And another trick in pie chart is when you have a lot of, so do not use pie chart if you have more than 6 slices. If it has more than 6 slices, nobody can anyways compliment it, anyways it's hard. The way to do it is when you have more than 6, let's say 7th, 8th, 9th, plug them together as other or sum of x, y, and z, and put that as a single slice so that it's easy to compare. Cut down distractions on your chart. Right. So if this is your sales, if you're selling, let's say 4 million, you're hardly bothered about your 23 cents and 56 cents. So why even tell that guy that this is 23 cents and 56 cents? Because the numbers here are huge. And when it's 4 million, it's hard to go 4,531. At this point in time, this guy's probably not even worried about that 31,000. So give him something like 4.53 million. This is an accurate representation. And this cuts down distraction, and suddenly your chart looks so much more cleaner. So this is fairly standard. When you're doing anything for projections, use dotted lines. Don't use the same line and write projected, because the visual perception does not go to read projected. Only when you go and read it cognitively, you read projected. But anything which is dotted comes up as, hey, you know what, this is different. You can either use dotted or you can use different colors. But different color is, in an industry parlance, used for highlighting a column which is still actual, and dotted is projected. Add effective
notation. I have also seen sometimes people using, I don't know if it's right or wrong, but one is a dotted line and they use lighter colors. I think the economist uses that, like when they have like an 8-year data, the first 6 would be like darker colors, and then the other 2 would be projected and they would kind of fade out, kind of.
Correct.
So just to show that visually they're different.
So they are printed magazine which is color blind friendly. So there's again a theory behind this, that when you use a dotted line, some people cannot perceive dotted line and they see it as a straight line. So there are color palettes which are color blind friendly. So even if you use light color and dark color, color blind people cannot actually perceive it. But then there are palettes which are color friendly on the print. So they have done their background on that part. So it can be used, but even then, when it's a different color, the perception of that depends on what you're thinking. Anything which is dotted, fundamentally, when you look at our English language, when we put 3 ellipses, that means, iske baad kya hua, I don't know. That's like, could be continued or could be not be there. It's like a maybe kind of a thing. So that is what people perceive it as, in terms of dots.
This example could be ghosts, right? How people show ghosts in films or comics. Or that
correct.
Matter. It's always either dotted or in a lighter palette.
Correct.
Which is to show that.
Simple trick, use annotations. Monthly revenue. Below this, since I joined this. So here. So what happens is then, very clear, you're making the guy first, before looking at the chart, he actually looks at it. And we're building a data visualization. So anyone of you who has studied the paintings of Rembrandt? So he uses a very interesting technique. First he etches his painting, and then he creates a painting with different light textures. So when you look at a static painting, because of the way light is there on the painting, it goes into an animated story. You first look at one part of the painting, then you look at another part, then you look at another part, and he is manipulating you through use of light on a black and white painting. What happens is, because your brain goes to the most active part and then it automatically figures out the visual function without you even knowing that you're doing it, you actually see the entire story on a painting. That is something which you can actually carry to a data visualization as well. You can use colors, you can use fonts, you can use shading. You can basically guide the journey of the audience on this chart the way you want it. For example, right now when you looked at this, look at what happened. My caption is actually smaller than this. You did not look at the caption when you came to look at the chart. You started looking at this, or you started looking at the colors. If I make this bigger, you're going to look at it. If I can remove this to remove junk, I can replace it to the right, because then you want to look from left to right. Based on what I want you to focus in a data visualization, you can do that. And that is a very subtle thing.
Is it data manipulation?
Or that's another topic altogether. So we'll go to the data manipulation part later.
There's a book on it, how to lie with charts.
Statistics.
Yeah, that's another. So I'll go to another article we have written. Tricks they don't teach you at business school.
Lies, damn lies, and statistics.
Yes. So they're saying if you beat the data hard enough, it will say anything you want it to. interactive features. So most of us are now doing development for web or mobile or whatever, so which means we can use interactive features. The moment you have options for interactivity, means you can cut down a static image. On a print, you don't have any other option because people cannot click. But let's say here you have all these things, you want to show these metadata, what happened in October, occupancy rate and anniversary discount. As a user, when I go here, I have too much junk. I already don't know what to look at. But in a chart like this, I see that something happened in October which gave this rise. So I just go and roll over it and I see additional details. So unless the user really wants to see additional details, don't force him to see all of that, because then he might just not see the entire chart. So your point of having a chart might be missed. Drill downs is a very common thing now in a chart. The few rules of drill down are, always start from the macro data and go down to micro data. Have clear categories. So like go from country to city to, let's say within city you have arrondissements in France, or you have like smaller sections. Don't do arbitrary jumps when you're drilling down. Second, when you're drilling down, use the same chart type. Always. Here we have, this is actually an error and this is the wrong thing which I wanted to show. That if that is a column chart and you're drilling down from a column chart, at all levels it should be a column chart. It should not change to any other chart type. On a drill down chart which allows drill down, tell people that you can drill down. Have a visual clue. So here, let's say we have written a click on a column, still it's not the best way because it does not appeal to the visual function. So you want to have something on top of that chart or a visual representation that, you know what, come and click on this chart. Very important. Otherwise people do not expect drill down on chart because they are not used to it as much today. That was on the chart. So small things, even when we do tables on a daily basis, tables can be enhanced massively. When we are presenting a simple table like this with data, it's very hard for people to understand or look at part of the table. But the moment we just colorize it, this is kind of similar to a heat map. The attention goes here. What happened here? Why is it so dark? And then you go and track. And then you can even add drill downs to this part. Another modification of this is this part. Not just color, but also the size, which means it can handle multivariate data. So with this, table is also data visualization, by the way. So how you can enhance those tables are limitless. There are tables which has there are tables which have bubbles in it as well. So very effective way to show large amount of data and then have a click action or a handler action or even hover actions on top of it, on top of each of these cells to link it to something else.
Isn't the other one actually like a lot of visual overload also?
Yeah,
the word
so on this screen you're seeing it when you actually see it on a PC, because here the colors are not reproducing properly. So this is a very light color palette when you look actually look at it.
So even on your screen it looks kind of hectic.
Here?
Yeah.
Actually when you put it up in a dashboard, it would not.
Because of space.
No, because these colors are indicative of something else. The entire dashboard is color driven. So these colors represent, each of these colors represent a state. And there are multiple other charts which also represent that state.
But in this heat map sort of visualization, I mean, no, so you were saying that this could be used for a multi variable sort of, you know, chart. I mean, data where you are also playing with the size.
Right. So there are two ways you can do it. So multivariate data, one is a bubble chart. This is three axis, x, y, and z.
Right.
there could be a fourth axis also based on color, which is, so this is your x, y, z is the size, and then you have a z1, which is the color, so intensity of the color, like what you see in a Google Fusion Maps table. Or this is another one for multivariate data, where color is already there. So you have an x, y value and color.
But kind of, for example, this is a well-known notion that just like we are not good at comparing angles, we are not good at comparing areas. So for example, if I ask you that circle and that circle, how what is the ratio?
Correct. Right. So a bubble chart is never for comparing individual data.
Yeah, yeah.
It's for comparing clusters of data. So you look at the cluster and say, so let's say this is cost per service and stickiness. So let's say I'm a services company and I've got multiple services.
Mm-hmm.
This is my cost of service and this is stickiness. So I can see where am I going right or where am I going wrong. Take this example as a investment chart.
Mm-hmm.
Duration of investment, returns, and the size of your bubble is how much money you have put in that investment. So if you see that the duration of investment, things which fall here, where you've been invested for long but it has not given you return, that cluster is something which you need to work on. Whereas things which are here means you're doing phenomenal. Whereas things which are here, you're doing pretty much okay.
Basically what you're saying is that the most important part of the axis should not be in the size, right? Because if, for example, if you're caring about where am I investing most, then this is a bad chart because you won't be able to visually compare.
Correct.
So by being careful about selection, so position can be indicated, relative size probably, but
so X and Y are your most important data points here because you're looking at the cluster and you're looking at where it is placed.
Right.
The size is a third parameter, not as important. The size, once you've figured out this is the cluster I want to work on, then you individually look at it and you go and hover over it.
One more thing I wanted to point out is, like at least from personal experience, we're looking at something like ggplot kind of this thing, where which has like five or six even variables, like color, size, everything. What I found that if you have more than three, the one, as you pointed out, is the gradient, x and y, and then the other things, like color is probably the third that is important. So that gradation is there, and if you have more than three variables, then it becomes extremely confusing for any user. At that point, we figured out that we have to go to the user and explain every time what that chart represents, and there is a cognitive overload if there are more than three parameters.
Okay, so human mind cannot interpret more than two parameters if you give him on a table. I'll give you a table of x, y and size. You can relate between x and y, but in a tabular format also between x, y and size you cannot.
Sure.
Visualization helps you do x, y and size. If you add a fourth parameter, which is color, that's a lot of cognitive overload. You can still add fifth parameter, and I'll tell you 100 different tricks to add fifth parameters. Let's say you can add a bar chart inside of this. You can add another bubble inside of this. You can do a hover over it to release another chart. You can have spiky hairs on top of it to represent another thing altogether. You can have a border around this. The strength of the border gives you another parameter.
No,
then
I get that, but what I'm saying is that the more information you add in the chart, Then the see, one thing is, like, as you said, the visual part kicks in and immediately we can figure out. But as soon as you start interpreting, that's when your cognitive function comes into picture.
So that's what
the whole point of, like, having a chart is that you should not have to think twice or interpret it.
Correct.
Which is what I found, like, from personal experience, that if you have more than three parameters, then it becomes, then it, that is when your brain starts interpreting. This is unscientific, anecdotal, but
absolutely. No, so this is scientific. You cannot compare.
I mean, on the lighter side of things, when you're making a product for a corporate and you're selling it, a cognitive overload can actually increase the price of the product. We've seen that happen a lot.
So
I can't understand it, so it must be good.
So that's actually right. If you pick up any of the McKinsey report and look at their charts, it just takes like insane amount of time even for me to understand what the hell are they trying to show. And they'll put a stack chart, not as one chart, they'll put six different columns as six different charts.
Mm.
And they'll put a column on the side of it showing projected.
Mm.
And you just cannot understand. Then you think that, yeah, it's nicely presented, it has so much of data, should be right.
Yeah.
So to solve your problem, actually, Google Motion Charts has done something very interesting. So what they do is, you have a drop-down of parameters here and you have a drop-down of parameters here. You can have 20 different parameters. So let's say you are comparing n parameters into n parameters. So that's a matrix of n into n. You select one from there, you select one from here. And then they also have something called motion. So let's say this is for January. How this changes in February and March, you have a play button which smooths out, and then you see that how the entire thing is traveling. That was actually started by Hans Rosling.
Yeah, I saw that talk. And actually, we eventually gravitated towards that when we kind of saw this kind of happening. Especially the time always we had that, like, for example, we had like one of the metrics was CTR and fill ratio. We saw it how it actually changed over like months of the year. So yeah, we actually eventually came to motion charge because without doing the animation kind of added another layer without adding like cognitive overload. And
correct.
That was very easy to represent.
So the animation only kicks in. So the step to comprehend that chart is you first look at the static bubble chart. You figure out the cluster you want to analyze. Then from the cluster you figure out one variable whose motion you want to see. Because we cannot track motion of two independent objects at the same time because we have to focus at one center point. So the step is still the same. They are doing it through animation. Using a static chart, you can tell the user, you know what, click on this thing to just see the animation of that particular variable over time.
Sure.
Because if everything is animated at the same time, it still is a whole lot of cognitive load.
Okay. So other observation was in the motion chart, just to complete the conversation, was in some cases you can use the trail. So the trail actually can be useful because even once the animation is done, you still see the trend because the size keeps on varying. So if it leaves a trail, it can actually make sense. Like for example,
correct,
revenue and as and maybe on two axis, and then is it increasing, is it decreasing, did it increase, did it, so you can see it in the motion, but that if you leave the trail, in some cases even that was like quite useful.
Correct. So again,
but then again, like with the caveat that there is alpha transparency, as like he was pointing out, and there are not too many variables, like maybe like 3 or 4, but if they're like 6, 7,
so
doesn't make sense.
You'd want to leave trail of only one, and the reason being because if the paths intercross for two variables, then it becomes very complicated.
True.
And if three of them go, so let's say what happens even with the alpha transparency, if three of variables go one on top of each, because of the alpha, the color actually changes. So
sure.
You know, blue plus yellow is equal to blue plus yellow is equal to green.
Sure.
So the other one is heat map. This is actually very effective and very underused chart. This heat map, if you actually were representing through a column chart, this would be either 6 or 12 column charts. You can compress 6 or 12 column charts across a multivariate data into this. So we have a nice example of how to compare restaurant listings on various parameters from various people in a single chart as opposed to 50 different charts. This is inspired by Stephen Pugh. These are condensed charts. So Sparklines was by Edward Tufte and Bullet and Crafts are by Stephen Pugh. This is basically a singular data point with a target value and a range. So you say like, this was my revenue target, bad, average, good. This was my actual target and this is what I achieved. So in a small space like this, you can actually achieve so much of information and it looks pretty neat. So here you can see we are actually measuring 10 KPIs. We are seeing historical context of 3 charts and here we are seeing stock price of 4 charts. That is a lot of information for one dashboard. This is just an example to show that how thinking beyond your standard chart, and this is a chart which most people would very easily comprehend. It's not very complex to understand.
But
do
you think there's too many data points?
There are. The idea was to show how much data point we can fit in a single screen using such chart. So I would not, I mean, the tops is 4 for any road. If it has every visualization has to drive a business outcome. If it's not driving a business outcome and you're not owner of that and responsible for that, you should not be seeing that visualization.
Perhaps also relevant here is that you should the difference between a dashboard and a visualization or your graph that you're showing a presentation is, in a presentation you want instantly to get that, right? In a dashboard, you have probably already comprehended what the contents are and you are looking at changes over time, or you know, you're familiar with the dashboard already. So that's why the you can potentially fit more into a dashboard, but if this were to be flashed on a PPT like it has been here, it would be very difficult to comprehend.
Okay. So you can put as much as you want,
yeah.
But the point is, would you be looking at that and be taking a call, right?
Mm-hmm.
So let's say, as a CEO of Fusion Charts, I would be happy to look at the number of leads. What can I do by looking at the number of leads?
Mm-hmm.
It's not in my hand. It's in the hands of my director of sales. That's his ownership. And the fact that if I look at leads and I take ownership of that, it means I'm not delegating it right. So I should not be even looking at it. My key metric is, what is my total revenue? What was promised by him? What did he achieve? If there is a disparity on in that, then I need to go and speak to him.
I mean, it's just like, I completely agree, because we have built business dashboards. So the first question which typically was thrown at us is, what is the call to action?
Mm-hmm.
Right? How, so that it has, like, for example, like if this is the chart, but it has like an indicator saying green or red. It immediately tells you, you know, something is right or something is wrong. So there's a clear call to action about what is there. Otherwise, it just becomes like a junk chart, because it is information, but especially when you're doing a dashboard. But the first question anybody will ask is, how is it relevant to me? And then what is the call to action or what actionable insight that I get out of it? So that actionable insight is like, clearly the first question that any business guy will ask you.
This is an example of when you're building dashboards. So I talked about a paradigm change right now. Like till now we are building dashboards for this, but when 90% of the world will be on smartphones, this will become your truck of the today, and people will be driving their saloon cars. Today we are building for the truck. Tomorrow we'll be building for the saloon cars. How do you? So there still has to be a link between that part and this part. How do you make the experience unified so that your dashboard or data visualization on a PC or Mac looks similar to what it is on an iPhone, but the paradigm is different? So if you look at some of the changes here, this is sales and quantity trends. We have not shown it by default. People know that there's a sales and quantity trend. There's a KPI here, which is important, which we have shown here, KPI right there. That means this is something which I want to look right away without another level of action. I might not be interested in this graph. If I'm interested, it's one click away. This thing here, average orders to deliver. Sorry, this is weekly sales. Average days to deliver order, this is 2. Now, a gauge here looks good because it's a filler. Whereas on a phone, you don't need a filler because your screen is already small. So some of the most complex data visualization on phones have to be very simple numbers or as simple graphics. If you look at some of the good dashboards on mobile phones are Fitbit's dashboard. Fitbit is a health band like Jawbone. Even Jawbone's is pretty good. Then you have a couple financial applications where most of the dashboards are not built of column charts or line charts. It's a simple percentage indicator. They have a round thing showing how much of that is complete. Because when you're looking at your KPIs on the move, you're only interested in knowing that particular thing and that particular number. If you need to get history on that, then you do a tap on it and then you go for it. So this is a different paradigm.
So at the cost of using the word responsive, have you been able to do something which works across a PC, an iPad, and a phone?
Yeah. So this is responsive to the exponential of responsive.
This is the same thing, right? Or is it a different code being?
It's absolutely different with a different.
On a responsive, the whole idea is that you don't build separately for a mobile phone and for a screen.
So you don't build. So the way we structure it, so it's like Java, right?
Yeah.
As a programmer, you program in Java. We would have ensured a Sun microsystem, it would run everywhere. Because then we build the ILS at the bottom of it so that it runs everywhere. Here, it's not that complex, but there's a whole lot of architecture behind it so that when you build something for a PC, that's a different architecture. When you build something for mobile. So think of things. Here, we do not have to worry about latency. Here, we have to worry about latency. How many times the server gets ahead? What do we have to cache? We cannot cache all the files here. How soon do we call the charts? When something is clicked here, because people are used to the app experience, they need a tactile feedback right there that I'm going to go load the data. Whereas on a PC and a browser, people can see the status bar and they see that something is happening. So the whole UX changes, IA changes, the architecture changes, the data packets change because you don't want to do too many server hits. Let's not get into the Android iOS and everything.
Okay. Yeah, I'm just curious whether you're doing a single solution which can be seen across devices, or do you make something catering to each kind of platform?
No, so we make a single solution.
Single API, but multiple implemented
separately for a mobile. And
so how come the HTML5 version isn't free where the Flash is?
Flash also, the previous version is free.
So, you have any plans of making it available?
Who will pay for my beer?
Corporate support.
And that's bad job. This is slightly, I would say, sketchy. But this is something which a lot of people need in data visualization. So we built a dashboard, a patient monitoring system on the iPad for doctors. Now doctors are used to seeing their ECGs and they're used to seeing their devices in real world. Suddenly if you give them very flat and very minimalistic look, they were like, what the hell happened? This doesn't look real, my patient will die. You guys are not doing the right thing. So we built something which exactly simulates a patient monitoring system in real life. So you can see the ECGs here. And all of these are real time. So this actually moves like an ECG every 350 milliseconds of sorts. These are actual thermometers and very realistic looking widgets. Any data visualization guru will tell you, avoid using this. This is skeuomorphic design where we are replicating things. But there will always be a section of audience whom you cannot make jump from the current thing to the absolute modern thing. This is the transition period. And yes, there's a whole lot of this big market which still needs this. So
how are the live updates done? Webshops?
I'm sorry?
How are the live updates
done? So we do it on HTTP, but you can use a persistent connection. We can even use WebSocket. So what we also do is we give you a client-side access to it. If on the client-side you have, you can open a socket to your backend, or you want to use a local applet. However, so you can either control it at the server side or at the client side. The choice is yours.
Okay.